John, what's the question you're asked most when it comes to independent film distribution, and how has your answer changed over the years?
Well, probably a few years ago it was, how can I get someone else to release my film? You know, is the common question. You know, it's like, why do I still have to do this work? You know, and I still get that from filmmakers, you know. But I think, you know, if I'm going to be Pollyanna-ish, which I tend to be Mr. Pollyanna, I feel like it's the debate has shifted from, oh my God, why do I have to do this? Isn't there someone else who's going to do this for me? And, you know, I want to get a sales agent so I can sell my film and move on. It's moved a bit from that to where filmmakers will start to entertain the idea that they have to be kind of engaged on a regular basis, kind of like musicians in a sense, that, you know, there's still some resistance or some questioning of how I do that as a filmmaker. But I think the desire and the awareness, we're kind of there now with that question of how do you engage audiences on a consistent basis, where we were 3 years ago with why do I have to release my film myself? So I think in 3 years, you know, which has been the transition period, I'm hoping that filmmakers, that in 3 years, the notion of engaging your audience on a consistent basis will be a non-issue. You know, just like now, it's less of an issue now with people understanding that they have to kind of take on this responsibility themselves. That, not even the responsibility, that even understanding that, you know, what I've been saying for a while is that filmmaking's a two-step process, or is this whole process, which includes making your film and engaging an audience, that that's all part of one whole, and you can't do one without understanding that you have to do the other. It's interesting because I'm going to this A2E conference on Thursday, which is TED's Artist Entrepreneur Conference up in San Francisco, and one of the things I'm supposed to do is say, is in 3 minutes, which I said, are you kidding? 3 minutes, me? And they said, oh, do you want it shorter or longer? And it's like, well, considering I usually talk for 2 days, you know, nonstop, I think 3 minutes is probably going to be pretty tough for me. So I don't think I've ever said anything in 3 minutes, which is, you know, one of my initial issues with Twitter is I have a hard time talking in short bites. But, you know, it's kind of like, what's the most exciting thing that's happened in the last year, in your opinion? And to me, it's filmmakers embracing the notion of serialized content, that, and not thinking about, like, I mean, if you want to put it in simplistic terms, of filmmakers thinking about moving towards the television model from a film model. And just like the more exciting things happening in drama, or a lot of the more exciting things in drama are happening not out of feature films, studio films, but are happening in television, or things that are similar to television, that I think the web is starting to mature where filmmakers can find satisfying creative expression with serialized form, which is the natural form towards engaging audience on a regular basis than a feature film. And to me, what I've started saying in a lot of workshops now or interviews is that I think we're going to get to the point where only making a feature film is like using a rotary dial phone. That, you know, it's more and more filmmakers have to understand that a feature film is one form that was developed a century ago, and that today, in order to engage audiences, while the feature form is still satisfying and I still like watching features, it's not the only media form that audiences want to connect with, and many audiences don't have the time for 90 minutes, won't engage you on a feature, you know, and that you want to think about the different ways that you can connect with audiences that will work around a feature film and will involve a feature film, but that if you're only thinking that you're going to make a feature film, you're going to get that out into the world, you're, to me, kind of shooting yourself in the foot, because you're not preparing for all the other kinds of audience engagement that might be possible. So for instance, you know, Bombit 2, which is I'm releasing as a feature soon, started as a web series and was born on the web as a web series. And then I figured, well, let's just try to put it together, see if it fits together as a feature, and which it did. And because I have certain ways to monetize content set up through Bombit 1, and there seemed to be an interest of Bombit 2 that I could actually make some additional revenue from releasing Bombit 2 in addition to the money that I made creating it as a web series. So, but when I made it into a feature, I also realized that I had shot a bunch of extra material, and so we created 10 other pieces of content that we're going to use to help promote the release of Bombit 2. In addition to that, we're also going to do an online web contest, you know, for people to submit their videos from all over the world of graffiti and street art. We're going to do a video contest and a still contest, a still image contest, and where the winners are actually going to end up on the Bombit DVD. So in a sense, it's kind of a form of contest crowdsourcing. And, you know, and so that's, if I only thought about Bombit as a feature film, I feel like I would really hamper, you know, my vision of how it can engage audiences in a sense. And, you know, I think the real forward-thinking filmmakers like Tiffany Schlein Joseph Gordon-Levitt, you know, who I say visionary filmmaker through his Hit Record program, who are engaging audiences in interesting ways, and Ed Burns does it too, to an extent, in terms of involving their audience in the creation, you know, and this is something that's been around for a while. You know, Star Trek, Timu from Finland did it with Star Trek, and as well with Iron Sky. But I think there's, you know, more and more interesting ways to do this. And I think, you know, that's just one example of how filmmakers should and can get beyond the feature form. And if you look at Tiffany, you know, a lot of her success has come not through features, but through shorts and through things that, you know, aren't one thing or another. You know, there's no label for them. So I think more and more, you know, and I teach at film school, and it's, you know, and there's this, still within students, there's this notion of the feature film, but you have to really look at the modern audience, and is that all they want to consume? And is that even the primary thing that they want to consume? You know, and that's not saying that you can't tell stories utilizing, you know, the moving image, but I think it's important for filmmakers to kind of reconceptualize how they tell stories.
Well, going back to Bombit 1, Bombit 1, now in hindsight, what happened with the release of Bombit 1 that at the time, or even the making of it, possibly seemed a little precarious, and now you're glad that it was this way? And then in the reverse, what was sort of a mistake that you won't duplicate?
Well, what was precarious in terms of what concerned me is when we were at Tribeca and we had, you know, 5 sold out audiences, you know, and then we didn't sell the film. So that was the sucky part of it, obviously. And that's what, you know, the only reason you're sitting here talking to me is because that happened. Because if I had sold my film and moved on to something else, you know, I wouldn't, you know, probably and have ended up being the person I am now in terms of this, you know, person who's, you know, delved into and thought a lot about alternative distribution models for filmmakers. You know, obviously, the lack of conventional success at Tribeca when we premiered the film, you know, kind of led me on this different path, which has opened up a world of opportunity to me. So it's, you know, I would say the main lesson is that, you know, if the thing that you are hoping for doesn't happen, what might happen is something better, you know. And I think that filmmakers should, you know, all artists should keep that in mind, that it's often the serendipity of life that leads you down the more interesting, fulfilling path. And so, you know, in a sense, it's almost thank God someone didn't buy my film, you know, really, when you think about it. So in terms of mistakes that I made, I wrote a blog for Sundance about that, like the 10 things that I would do differently. that, and now I'm forgetting all of that. Probably because I'm in release mode, and so I'm not thinking about the things that I failed in and only thinking about the good things. You know, I've talked about the t-shirts a lot. that I made t-shirts that were very nice for an audience that was not my audience. So, you know, I should have done some better audience research on the kinds of t-shirts that they wanted. And I made these very nice shirts for people who, you know, women who shop in, you know, Fred Siegel. And because my wife was advising me on the fabric, and, you know, I like those kind of shirts too, to be honest. But it's not, my audience doesn't wear those kinds of shirts. So that's, I mean, that's a minor thing. I'm trying to think of, you know, because a lot of it was that at the time, certain things just weren't possible, you know, as they are now. So it's hard to say that I potentially made a mistake about the way I did things then, you know, because a lot of what I did with Vomit One, you know, I was still operating within a certain set of ideas and conceptions, and through releasing Vomit One and also Joffrey and working with the filmmakers that I've worked with since, you know, it's a constant process of discovery. But especially, you know, one of the things that I like to do, and what I think that, you know, in terms of the work that I do that I offer filmmakers, is that, you know, I'm constantly actually doing the work. You know, and so not just making films, but releasing films and trying new different things to see what will work and what works and what doesn't work. And I think that that's, like, I use pretty much everything I do is research, you know. And so, you know, like doing this contest, for instance, you know, to help to aid the release of Vomit 2 is kind of a research project. And then fortunately, I, you know, part of the reasons I kind of put it off for a while is because to run a contest, it's very difficult, and it's very, you know, if you don't have a like, what is the structure for that? And then I just happened to run into a guy who had developed, you know, who was working with a company that had developed a structure for storytelling. But then we were talking about it, and I said, well, couldn't you just use this also as a contest platform? And he said, oh yeah, I guess we could. And I said, well, why don't you, because they're in beta mode. And I said, well, why don't you just beta test a contest format with Bomba 2? And they said, great. And so we're doing it. It'll launch, you know, it should be, by the time some of this runs, it should be active. Like, it's supposed to launch May 18th. And I think we're going to do three contests over the course of 3 months. So May 18th to June 18th. And the dates may change slightly. And then June 18th to July 18th and July 18th to August. We'll see if we end up doing three or two. We'll see what happens. You know, but one of the things that, you know, it's good to have long-term audience engagement, but it's also good to have particular points of activity that have beginnings and ends in order to mobilize activity. So while we've been keeping the Bomit brand alive for the last 5 years, and I guess one of the regrets, you know, we've been keeping the brand alive, and, you know, we have 15,000 Facebook likes now, which has grown from 2,000 even just 2 years ago. But now I want to use that as well as the influencers that we've kind of, like, been working with or are aware of or friends with over the last number of years to kind of, like, push into this one, you know, kind of promotional campaign, as it were. And we're going to see what it's like to run a crowdfund campaign simultaneously, you know, and I'm going to set the bar really low, you know, partially because my audience in general doesn't pay for things. So that's one thing. You know, my graffiti audience tends to not to pay for things. And secondly, I just want to see how those things will dovetail, doing the contest and doing the crowdfund. And thirdly, it's like, you know, we're a little, in a sense, the crowdfund campaign's a little late, in a sense, because it's right before the release. So in a sense, it's more of a pre-sale than anything else, you know, which I know has been done before. But as Sherry has pointed out to me, you know, it's like, well, then what's your call to action, in a sense, you know? And so I'm still figuring that out, you know, what that call to action is. And that's another reason why I want to keep the bar low, because I just... you know, I want to do it for engagement and participation. And in a sense, you know, when I was pretty much ready to nix the crowdfund campaign, I figured actually what's better for my audience instead of asking for something is like I give them something. I'm giving them an opportunity, my audience an opportunity to engage and show their work and participate in this contest. And then I'll showcase the winners in a sense. But I think that it might be good to dovetail that if you want to contribute, you can contribute in this way, or you can contribute in this way. You can either contribute some of your work, or you can contribute money. You know, you choose in a sense. So that'll be interesting. We'll see. You know, it's gonna, you know, I have another week to decide.
John, what surprises you more, that Zach Braff was able to raise over $2 million mm-hmm. in 5 days on Kickstarter, or the backlash he's receiving for doing it?
I would say the backlash, because Zach Braff raising $2 million in 5 days on Kickstarter, that doesn't surprise me. You know, what's interesting is that, to me, people that I know have been saying for years, a couple years, like, we can't wait until bigger celebrities get involved because they'll bring a whole new audience into this and make people more comfortable and used to doing crowdfunding. And to me, that is my opinion on it. It's like, I don't really understand the backlash, actually. To me, the backlash, I don't even understand the backlash because, like, really, what does it hurt for someone like that to do this? You know, because it's like, oh, well, he has enough money to pay for it on his own. Well, why? You know, why should he, you know, why not engage your fans and give them ownership over what you're doing? I mean, I don't understand. It really baffles me, you know, why anyone would be opposed to this, because for the whole community, it's a good thing because you're bringing more people into the Kickstarter community, just like Veronica Mars as well. And granted, those people are specifically those people's fans and aren't going to translate into other people. But once they get used to it, they might look around, you know, not everyone, but even if 10% of those people who never did a Kickstarter campaign or contributed to a Kickstarter campaign look around for other projects, you know, and if 10% of those people contribute, you know, that's a win. You know, I think, you know, what's ironic is that people complain about, oh, I'm sick of getting hounded for crowdfund campaigns. It's like the same group of people hounded over and over again. But by the same token, when these two campaigns come out that expand the reach of crowdfunding, everyone bitches and moans about it. And to me, you know, I have to say that, you know, being a filmmaker as well, I'll say filmmakers are a group of people who like to complain. You know, and that was the thing that always struck me about film school. What we would do is sit around the halls and complain about film school. You know, and then when you're out of film school, you complain about something else. And then it's something, and I think it goes to filmmakers being, and you have to be kind of critical to be a filmmaker. You have to be, to make a good film, you have to be critical of your own work. You know, you have to, there's something about that. And so, you know, maybe you can tell me what some of this, I mean, I've read some of the blogs, but they still seem so stupid to me, you know.
Some of the sentiment that I've heard is that, you know, Kickstarter and Indiegogo and platforms like that should be kind of for, quote, the people, that you're supposed to be an indie artist. And I get that, but then what, is there like a litmus test as to what, who's indie? Like, yeah, exactly. Is there a threshold?
I mean, like, I would have to say that I think those are the indies. The indie people who are saying that Kickstarter and Indiegogo are for indie people. You know, it's like, you know, the people who think that indie stuff is only for indies are people who are complaining that they can't make a living. You know, and the way that you should function as an artist is to be as inclusive as possible as to who your audience is and want to constantly expand that audience into people. Why wouldn't you? Why do you not want to engage more audience and expand your audience and to have other people possibly seeing what you do? And Zach Braff, again, it goes to the thing. It's like to think that Zach Braff coming in and doing a Kickstarter is going to hurt you means that Kickstarter is a zero-sum game. And it's not a zero-sum game. It's not, you know, it's I don't know the statistical analogy of what the opposite of a zero-sum game is, so... but all I know is that by someone giving the Zach Braff doesn't mean that your small little project is going to get one less funding person. You know, it doesn't work like that. It's not this finite pool of money that, you know, this person has or this person has. What you have to do in crowdfunding is find your audience and encourage them to engage with you. And if you're not doing that, then you're not going to succeed. And Zach Braff has nothing to do with that. And there's your sound quote. I mean, there's your sound bite. That, and that's, I should write that down, you know, but Zach Braff has nothing to do whether you're engaging your audience effectively, you know, that's your problem, you know, and, you know, what I think is interesting is that, you know, I think more and more celebrities will do this for their pet projects, and I think that's a good thing, and I think filmmakers can learn from that and see, you know, because a lot of what, I think what's crowdfunding is moving away from a merchandise platform to an experiential platform. And to me, in a sense, it's not what's key in that is that it's a scarcity platform, in a sense, that you're selling scarcity. And that in the world of digital, of a world of abundance, is what becomes valuable is what is scarce. And so certain kinds of merchandise are scarce and you can make them scarce and those have a chance of doing well so long as you are smart about like making something that your audience wants. But you are also smart to create experiences. And who was I just talking to about their campaign? Yeah, I was talking to a filmmaker who was actually in the A2E Summit, so it was my pre-consultation with them. And they have a band involved in the film. And I think what's really interesting is that you can create these different levels of experiences, again, from the music model, and value those to and allow consumers to engage at the level that they want to engage in or are able to engage in. And that, you know, you'll have some really high-end rewards, a super VIP package that only certain people will be able to afford. But what crowdfunding allows you to do is to engage in those tiers. And so you can still create a smaller end package where someone can come to, you know, get a standard VIP pass, come to a screening, go backstage, you know, and meet the band for however long. But then you can do a super VIP package where they actually have dinner with the band and filmmakers before or after the screening. You know, why not? You know, and I think these are all just, I think we're still in a kind of experimental mode of how this new form of engagement and financing and marketing is all going to work. And I don't think it's right for anyone to say some people can come to the party and others can't. What, you know, you're gonna see is when crowdfunding expands beyond art and where any kind of, when small businesses start using crowdfunding. And again, why not? You know, the banks don't supply funding to small businesses, you know, so, you know, it'll be wise for small businesses to start up, any kind of business to start up and start and to use that kind. And they do it in Indiegogo all the time. Kickstarter is limited to art, but Indiegogo, you see all kinds of small businesses doing different things. And so what's the difference? Yeah, anyway, it's enough. I mean, the whole issue is, to me, it's a non-starter. It's like, it's just a bunch of people want to complain. For me, I can't wait for Tarantino to do a crowdfund campaign. I can't wait for George Clooney to do a crowdfund campaign. It's like, you know, those people should be doing, you know, I want Tarantino to finance his next film, you know, through a crowdfund campaign. Why not? You know, and I think he potentially could do some really interesting things that, and he has an audience base that will do it, that will engage with him. And, you know, and I think you're going to start, I hope you start seeing bigger and bigger filmmakers and personalities start to do it. And then part of that is not just that people get used to Kickstarter, but in terms of giving over money, but that they get used to the kinds of experiences that they can expect or can engage with through Kickstarter. And then that opens up their possibilities in a sense, their minds as audience members as to what's possible. And then hopefully that will then encourage other filmmakers to do or other artists to do similar kinds of things, which just expands the possibilities. You know, for me, it's important at this time to think about expansion as opposed to contraction. You know, and for people to complain about Zach Braff, it's about contraction. you know, let's keep this little thing for our club, you know, and to me that never works, you know, and because then that's the death of a culture, in a sense, when you try to keep it only for the select few. You know, I'm not saying that you want to purposefully promote it to the mass, but if you try to constrict it, that, I think, causes issues. And to be honest, it's not about what are we looking at, it's about finance, you know, and is finance really, you know, ever anything about some select club? I mean, you know, I think that those people who complain about Zach Braff should be more concerned with making better art.
John, for anyone who one day plans to sell their film, if you had a chance to sit them down and have sort of a heart-to-heart with them, keeping with the sort of Pollyanna rose-colored glasses mentality, which is good. Some people don't like too much realism. I like that. So before they invest thousands of dollars in this project and years, years of their time, what would you want them to know?
Well, I would want them to know that no one's going to come and hand them a pile of cash at the end of the process and say, thank you very much. That's so wonderful that you did this. And, you know, we're all really happy. And here's your money back. And here's a wonderful audience for you. Like, that's number one, you know. And the sooner people recognize that and realize that, I guess the second number two is that to understand that audience building takes time, you know, and shouldn't be just for one project, but you should think and conceptualize how your audience, how you're going to engage with your audience throughout your career and hopefully bring those people from one project to the next. I'd say, and then the third thing is, I guess related to that is, you know, to start the process as early as possible, you know, and that if they can't do it, bring on someone as part of the process to help. You know, it doesn't necessarily always have to be in the beginning, you know, doesn't always have to be, but I think you want to at least conceptualize your audience engagement path at the beginning. Whether you engage it at the beginning or not is one thing, but you want to at least conceptualize a version of that at the beginning so that you can then create materials that you'll need later for that engagement process. And I would just say number four is that, you know, to take advantage of the tools that are available to expand the storytelling process that are now, to really think about, you know, to think more expansively in terms of how audiences engage with story, and to think that potentially there's a win-win in terms of having your audience engage with your story throughout the process with you, and what that can result in terms of the audience owning that process with you, and how that will benefit you as a filmmaker. And I think it's important, you know, as much as possible for filmmakers to get beyond this notion that, you know, and I've suffered from this notion many times myself, being a director, and especially coming out of the very strong resurgence of the auteur theory in the 80s with Scorsese and Spike Lee, etc. You know, that while there is a role of the director in terms of knowing, you know, what the project is about and being a guiding principle and having the vision for the project, you know, I think it's equally important for directors to be open to collaboration and ideas. They just have to be strong enough and talented enough to filter and make sure that those ideas fit within their vision, and to not just think that your only collaborators are your crew. And I think the smart directors do collaborate with their crew. But now what is new is that there's potential to collaborate with your audience, and that oftentimes you can get amazing content and ideas from your audience as much as from your crew collaborators. Like, even Bombit, a lot of that was crowdsourced. Like, I would say 70% of the music of Bombit was crowdsourced, you know, and we did it in a more primitive fashion because the internet tools weren't really available for it at the time, but we did it on a basis of just calling out to people and putting calls out to the internet, etc., in a very rudimentary fashion, because this was like, remember, this is 2007, so it's like 6 years ago now. And it's back when MySpace was the thing and Facebook barely existed. So, you know, those are centuries in the digital landscape. And so that's what I would say is to be, you know, yeah, I don't know where that fell in the 1, 2, 3, 4. But yeah, I guess it would be to collaborate with your audience as much as your crew.
At what point did you know the composite of your audience member, like who they were? After you made Vomit, because you said you'd made these t-shirts.
Yeah, no, I knew who my audience was while I was making Vomit, you know, and the t-shirts were a total brain fart, you know, and it's like how you can get caught up into doing what you want to do and not, you know, and still not pay attention, you know, and so shit like that's going to happen with every project, and you just got to cut yourself some slack and, you know, move on, and what, cost myself, you know, I probably still have $600 worth of t-shirt inventory that I haven't sold, you know, because of that. Okay, so that's $600, you know, I've made, there's many worse mistakes to make than a $600 t-shirt manufacturing mistake. So, you know, yes, it was a mistake, but I learned from it and, you know, wasn't that costly, you know. So, so anyway, did that answer your question or what?
But just so you said, all along you knew who you were making this film for. You knew who would be watching.
Pretty much. I mean, yeah. You know, it was pretty clear who our audience was going to be, and it pretty much has been that audience. The one thing that I didn't realize actually about my audience is how much they would resist paying for the content, you know, and you know, like I just found Bomb It Up on YouTube in its entirety with 100,000 views recently that I have no connection to. And I could take it down, right? But it's like, fuck, it's 100,000 views. Why am I going to take it down? That's actually, there's some value in that for me. Now, if there was a method, which there's starting to be, what I would like is to be able to call YouTube and say, look, I don't want to take this down, but I want the ad revenue to funnel to me now, not to this guy. That's the difference. You know, I don't want to do DCMI takedowns. I want to just be able to call YouTube and say, channel the revenue to me. So, I have to talk to them about that. There's a company that's doing that for the studios, but they're not, it doesn't scale for independence, unfortunately. So, hopefully within 5 years, it'll scale for independence. But anyway, that's sidetracking. You know, that was the one thing about my audience. Yeah, is that how, and I should have been aware of that. I should have known, like, look, these are people who, you know, don't blink about committing, you know, breaking rules, let's put it that way. So are they really going to engage with my content in the way that I want them to, which is going to monetize it? And chances are no. So, you know, but that's, you know, it's just a matter of, like, you know, what I have to learn from that is to then think about, and that's something I have to talk to my aggregator about, is to think about how I can put up Vomit for free and still monetize it, you know, for or Vomit 2, and even as we re-release Vomit 1, how I can put it up into various forms for free and still monetize it. So that would be pushing Netflix, you know, over other platforms, pushing Hulu over other platforms, probably pushing YouTube over other platforms and having it on YouTube for free simultaneously, just because it's going to happen anyway, so I might as well be the one doing it.
John, we had this question come in from Brian E. Kidd on Facebook. What are the best resources for keeping up to date with or ahead of the trends in distribution, i.e. new platforms, new models, the ones that are emerging as significant, the ones that are failing and dropping away, etc.?
So that's, I wish I had one answer for that. Because my intention at one point with the book was to create a website that would do precisely that. That became too much work, and I still want to do that. And Sherry Candler and I talk about doing that. We talk about doing a PMD site, which would do that. It's just a matter of, that has not happened yet. So, one of these days it will, maybe. So in lieu of that, I would say following Ted, you know, Ted Hope, following Sherry, you know, following me, you know, and I'm trying to think of who else, you know,
film
is out there. You know, Film Collaborative. I think the Filmmaker Magazine site has, you know, distribution and marketing, pretty active distribution and marketing blog. And they're kind of, they're going to relaunch the site that will have ways to access a lot of information in a more robust fashion. So I would say that. IndieWire as well. But the thing is that what you want to do is be able to kind of like, you know, archive it in a way and look back on it. So, you know, so I would say that, you know, those resources, you know, it's a lot, but I would just, you know, just set up your blog reader to, you know, capture, you know, and set up your Twitter feed for, you know, those people and those places, and you're probably going to be pretty okay, you know.
John, what's in a standard film distribution contract?
Oy. What's in the standard film distribution contract? Well, okay, it depends on what the contract. There is no standard film distribution contract anymore, I'd say. There's an all rights deal. There's, you know, aggregation deals. But I guess there are certain terms that are similar. So there's always term, length of term, territory, like what territories it covers, what rights, you know, the rights that are granted, what, you know, project it covers. And so what rights are granted, so whether it's a television contract, a, you know, a conventional digital contract, an all rights deal, theatrical, whatever have you. And then, you know, how money is paid back, and what the rev share split is, if it's a rev share, if there's an advance, if there's any kind of guarantees in terms of, you know, if there's an MG, which is a minimum guarantee, if there's any sort of P&A guarantee or promise, if there's a certain number of territories or platforms that are promised, you know, those kinds of guarantees, then kind of certain standard terms and conditions such as warranties, you know, accounting provisions, notice provisions, those kinds of things. But in general, it's what the project is, what the term is, what the territory is, what rights, what the rev share split is, and then what, if any, guarantees. And then I would say, in addition to all of that, what you want to do is have ways to carve out your own, carve out direct-to-fan rights within that. Part of the rights that you would give in terms of, are not just in terms of the scope of rights, in terms of what rights territory it is in terms of digital television, but also whether it's exclusive or non-exclusive, and even if it's exclusive, if there's any sort of direct-to-fan exclusion out of that.
And then, so John, out of those terms, you know, how can you negotiate? What can you negotiate? You know, what belongs to you? What are you giving away?
Well, you own everything. If you're the copyright holder, you own everything. And then what are you giving away? What you decide to give away. And what you decide to give away is what makes sense in terms of your goals to give away. And I don't say money, because money isn't the goal for everyone. So you have to, again, figure out what your goals are, and you have to see how this deal fits into meeting your goals. Well, how you negotiate depends on how much the person, the entity, wants your film. If the entity, if there isn't a great desire on the part of the entity who's the distribution company acquiring the film, then you don't have really great leverage. You know, they might like it enough in order to put it on their platform, but they may not like it much more in order, they may not give you a minimum guarantee, for instance. And so, you know, if they really want your film, which is what, you know, classically happened at Sundance with bidding wars when you had multiple entities wanting your film, and then you could negotiate for more. So generally, the amount of power you have and what you can ask for is determined by essentially how many people want your project, you know, and if only one person wants your project, then you don't have as much leverage. Okay, so again about Zach Braff, you know, one other thing, and maybe I touched on this earlier, is that you have to remember there was a time when Kickstarter started and then people weren't raising that much money, that me and Peter Broderick and a number of people are saying that you don't do Kickstarter for money. You do it for engagement, you know, you do it for audience building. And so, you know, Zach Braff, even though he's rich, doesn't necessarily have a connection with his audience. But why are you, if he's starting to create one, why would you hold that against him? I think it's great. I mean, everyone in my world says it's important for artists to start engaging with their audience and have a connection with them. So is that only for artists who are unknown? Like, why is it bad for, you know, Kevin Smith to have a relationship with his audience? Or again, I'll say Tarantino, who I think is ripe for this. So that's one additional issue. I guess the issue you were saying as far as if the film goes into profit, you know, I think, so why were people not upset about Louis C.K. Going direct to fan for his comedy special? People celebrated that. And then when he was hugely successful, he started donating the money to charity. So, you know, give Zach Braff a break. You know, maybe if his film goes into profit, then maybe he'll do something great with the money. You know, it's like, you know, I don't know him. You know, I can't say what he will or won't do. But, you know, it's Mr. Pollyanna. I like to think that, you know, generally artists, when they get money, tend to do good things with their money as opposed to other people who make a lot of money and often don't do good things with their money. You know, so, you know, let's just be hopeful and think that, you know, if he makes his film and it's successful, that in some way he shares the wealth on some level, you know.
What would you say is the number one reason that someone will not get a distribution deal for their film?
The number one reason that people won't get a good distribution deal for their film is probably because their film sucks. Sorry. You know, it's like, you know, just because you make a film doesn't mean, you know, A, that it's good, or B, that there's an audience for it. Now, granted, someone could make a film that's not that good, but there's still an audience for it. And, you know, and again, you say distribution deal, you know, I think generally why people wouldn't get a distribution deal is because their film isn't good, and or the distributors don't think there's a market for it, that they, by purchasing the film, they won't be able to sell it to someone to return their investment, or even if they don't purchase it, whatever money or work they put in won't be profitable. So, and I think there's plenty of distributors who buy films that probably aren't that good, but are profitable, you know, and there's plenty of distributors who buy films that are neither good nor profitable. But, you know, I think the real question is, you know, not to think about like why distributors would buy or not buy a film, but to think about, you know, what is your motivation for making the film? You know, how you can make that film as good as it can be, and how can you connect with an audience around that film? And to me, those are the same issues whether you do it yourself or, you know, or with a team. Do it direct to fan or with a distributor. I think those are the things that you need to consider, you know, and those are the things that distributors consider as well, you know, and it could be the greatest film in the world, but if a distributor still doesn't think there's an audience for it, you know, they're not going to pick it up. And that happens all the time where there's amazing films that don't get released by traditional distribution mechanisms. And that's why I think it's really important for filmmakers and all artists to think about how they're going to connect with their audiences, you know, and not be reliant on someone else.
Jon, how often would you say that a filmmaker reaches out to you with, let's say, 5 days left in their crowdfunding campaign, and you want to help them?
So you mean in terms of reaches out in what way? You know, like help my campaign?
Pretty much.
I get that once a week and I ignore it. You know, it's like, I don't know, if someone's just saying, I ignore, and you know, for better, anyone who just says, oh, Jon, help me with my crowdfunding campaign. You know, to me, it's like, I don't have a relationship with you. You know, you're reaching out to me when you just want money or you want my help getting you money. It's like, well, you haven't learned anything from any lesson that I've ever taught. You know, it's like, why, what is the point, why would I engage with you at that point? You know, if you want to engage with me in advance of that, in any way, shape, or form, even to ask me a question on Twitter and seek my advice on something or make a joke or somehow involve me as a person, great. And then you have a crowdfund campaign and you say, hey, John, could you do this because we have a relationship? Sure. But I don't even keep track of how many people say, oh, promote my this, that, or the other thing, and I don't have a relationship with them, and I ignore it, and I feel perfectly fine ignoring it because that person hasn't made the effort to have a relationship with me. It's pretty easy to have a relationship with me, I have to say. You know, I'm pretty busy, and sometimes it takes me some days to get back to people and stuff, and, you know, but generally, it's rare that I don't, within a couple of weeks, respond to everything. So, you know, with that being said, if you haven't tried, then you're not really, you know, you're not trying hard enough.
So is that, are those things that you would love to tell them, but either don't have the time or...
Though, yeah, I don't even bother at that point. It's like, you know, it's like, it's just, it's not my job to tell people that I'm not engaging with them when they're asking me to help them make money when they haven't engaged me beforehand, because I say that all the time to people. So you obviously haven't read my book. And so if you haven't read my book, then why are you asking me to help you? So when my book is so cheap and easily available, you know, and even, and generally if you ask me for a free copy, generally I'll give you a free copy. So with that being said, it's interesting that, you know, people need to remember that, you know, that we're in an exchange-based economy or a referral-based economy, and that, you know, if you want to someone to do something with you, you have to provide them value on some level, you know. And I'm not saying that to be selfish or, you know, demanding or anything like that, but you have to start practicing those muscles or exercise those muscles in order to be successful. And the other thing is, if you're coming to me for help in the last 5 days of your crowdfund campaign, chances are you're too late. Because, and this is the thing about crowdfund campaigns that people don't understand, the way you structure your campaign is how you're, will largely determine how you're, whether you're successful or not. And that goes in terms of how much you ask for, what your rewards are, what your positioning is, what your call to action is, all of that, which is in the structuring of the campaign, will help determine whether you're successful or not. So, and that's why 5 days before the end of the campaign is most likely too late for any kind of help that I can provide, you know, or I would want to provide, you know.
John, should independent filmmakers finance their film with credit cards?
No. I mean, I usually don't say a blanket no to anything, because, hey, there's a lot of ways to skin a cat, you know? Well, not that cats should be skinned, but, you know, but I don't think it's a good idea, especially these days, to really go into usury-oriented debt, which is what credit card debt is. It, many credit cards are 20% interest, and that's really a burden. However, I also do feel that most creative projects need to start somehow. And, you know, I always, Francis Ford Coppola once said, and I took this to heart, that no one else is going to jump into your project unless you show your own commitment and putting your own money in. And many artists don't have their own money outside of credit cards. So, you know, I think that it's not terrible for a project to get started in that way. But I would recommend highly that filmmakers don't get too burdened with debt so that it really impacts their lives in a deleterious fashion. And I think now there are so many possibilities to be creative and engage audiences that don't involve a lot of capital that weren't possible 20 years ago, 10 years ago, even 5 years ago, that, you know, there isn't as much of a need for people to go into credit card debt to make a piece of work.
Right, well, I've heard of documentarians putting, let's say, plane tickets overseas to get the main, you know, subject of their film on credit cards, and mm-hmm. then going from there and finding investors. But I mean, what if someone doesn't have the audience to go and crowdfund for it? So that's out the window.
Mm-hmm.
So you're saying just a small portion to sort of show that you have some skin in the game, but then find alternative.
Yeah, and I don't want to advise anyone one way or another in terms of credit cards, you know, because the first thing I'll say is that it is a problematic way of financing a project, you know, because of, you know, the exorbitant interest that's charged, and it's kind of a hard hole to get out of. So barring that, you know, I think at some points you do have to float certain aspects of a project, you know, and credit cards are certainly one way of doing it these days. You know, but I do feel like, you know, if you don't have an audience to crowdfund, I think what you need to start thinking about, and this is would be healthy for your whole project, is to start thinking about how you can create that audience, you know, and to, you know, spend some time simultaneously engaging that audience in addition to making the work. And the thing is that, and again, I was just talking to a filmmaker yesterday, you know, if you have a continuity to your work so that it makes sense for you to bring your audience along in your creative process throughout your career, any work that you invest in audience development now is going to pay off later. So, you know, you got to start somewhere, and, you know, the sooner the better. Like, start with a small crowdfund campaign, you know, amongst whatever network that you have, and then a year later, do another one. You know, it's like, you can't go back to the well too often, but so long as you're growing as an artist and the project is developing, you know, I think there's room for that.
Let me throw out another hypothetical filmmaker.
And also, the traditional crowdfund model isn't the only crowdfund model. I mean, I think there's, you know, if you look at Voto, which is in a sense reverse crowdfunding, you know, that's another way to go. And the people who made Pioneer One, you know, where they made, that's a serialized content, and they made an episode, and then people contribute to the further making of the next episodes. I mean, that's another model.
Yeah, I guess I'm just wondering how much should you put yourself sort of at financial peril? Let's suppose somebody's 50, they have an IRA, it's not enough to retire on, but it's a nice little chunk of change. Should they take that step and crack it open, get the penalties, knowing that, you know what, this may not serve me in retirement, but you know, I can make my dream come true?
That's, who's this coming from? I mean, that's, you know, it's hard to say. I mean, everything is so individualized. You know, I'd happy to sit down and talk to that person. And on the one hand, you don't want to put yourself in financial peril. But on the other hand, at some point, you know, art is about taking risks, you know, and you never know what's going, the world's going to be like. And, you know, why not? At some point, you have to take the plunge. But by the same token, I would, you know, be tempered about making sure that you really have the ability, that dream is really going to come through in some way before you put your life at risk, you know. It's interesting, I don't know if you guys follow this guy Bob Leffitz, who writes about music all the time. He has a daily, if sometimes three times a day blog that you can RSS, and he's constantly telling musicians, you know, to quit, you know, because you don't have enough talent, you know. Yeah. And he's constantly, they have an opposite problem where musicians, he's complaining about an opposite problem where musicians are only concerned about developing audience and not making work. Whereas filmmakers are more concerned, if I complain about anything, that filmmakers are too obsessed with making work and not enough about the audience. And I think they have to be obsessed with making the work, but they also have to be concerned about making audience. And he says there's way too many in the music world who are just, all they want to do is develop audience and tweet and Facebook and blog and, you know, but their music's crap. So, and he constantly tells them, get out of the business. You know, it's like too hard. You know, you're never going to succeed. So, you know, I would just say that's a really hard question to answer.
John, can you give us a few reasons why people succeed at crowdfunding?
Phew. you know, I'd say the easiest blanket statement would be because they set up their project properly, you know, and they strategized it well. And they, you know, and what people need to think about is that crowdfunding is very much like making a film, you know, that it's a lot of prep, you know, and all the more work you do in the prep, it's going to benefit you in production. That if you prep properly, the production will be much smoother. And if you don't prep properly, you're going to be scrambling, you know, and then there's post, there's the follow through. So, you know, I think being realistic about who your audience is and how much of an audience you have and making that, you know, sync with your goal. And then also thinking about your audience and potentially what they'd want from you in terms of rewards and providing those and providing creative and interesting rewards, you know, having a compelling call to action and compelling video and being personable and then, you know, working it or, you know, having enough people on board to help work it during the campaign, you know, and that's, you know, what I would say, you know.
Do you think people can take their social media as a collective of the project and kind of break it down and say, well, I'm assuming if we have X amount of Facebook followers, X amount of Twitter followers, realistically we're going to be able to get this much. You think that works?
I mean, I think you have to be very pessimistic, you know, and really look at conventional online conversion, you know, and online conversion is, you know, at best 1%. So, you know, which is very, so if you have 10,000 followers, say, which I almost do, say, so I have 8,000 followers on Twitter, and if I convert 1% of those to even look at my Kickstarter page, right, so what is 1% of 10,000? You know, I'm a math guy, so 10% is 1,000, so 1% is 100. Not much, right? So if I do a 1% conversion from my followers, so that's 100. And if I get 1% of those people to then convert from the conversion, because the first conversion is the click, the second conversion is the buy, that's one person out of my 10,000 followers who are going to contribute. Now, I think I'm probably going to do better than that, but if I really want to be conservative, that's what you're looking at. So, yes, you can use your followers, but you have to be very conservative about what, realistic about who you're going to convert. Now, I probably, you know, will have a higher conversion rate because I feel like, you know, I feel like I followed my, you know, 80-20 rule in that, you know, I feel like I provide a lot of value to my followers and I think I've maybe engendered goodwill amongst them, I like to think. And I know there's certain people that I can call on to act, you know, and I've contributed to campaigns, etc. So, you know, I think, you know, you have to, so it's not an easy calculation, let me just put it that way. It's not just saying, oh, I have 8,000 people, so 8,000 people will contribute, or 4,000 will contribute, and Kickstarter says the average is $70, so then 4,000 times 70 is $40,280,000. So I'm going to set my goal at, I'm going to be conservative and set my goal at 200,000. You know, that's crazy town. You know, you're not, that's, it's not going to work like that.
John, what's on the slate for the second half of 2013?
So first is, and I think we've talked about the release of Bomb It 2. And I think we've kind of covered that a bit. Then I'm also producing a documentary about breast cancer, which is being shot mostly in Baltimore, but we also went to Catania, Sicily to film the festival of St. Agatha, who's the patron saint of breast cancer. And that is, you know, we're going to be done cutting the film, hopefully, you know, in the fall, and with an eye towards releasing in October 2014. But what's interesting to me about that project, besides the director's really amazing, is that the film, to me, when I heard what the director wanted to do with the film, is I immediately said, you know, that's not a film, that's a transmedia project. And that your film, since she wants to do this verite film about these particular characters, is this one thing, but that all these other expansive ideas that she's had and we've developed during discussions are part of a larger project, which is going to be what is shorthanded called a breast cancer world map, where we're actually going to be seeding that with stories, extra stories that we filmed through our production, but we're going to also, our first foray to expand that is to go to India and to film a hospital and a doctor and patients in Mumbai, and then also encourage other women from around the world to upload their stories. And in addition to that, we're going to have kind of a historical timeline to breast cancer treatment, because the director teaches at Johns Hopkins, so she has access to the Johns Hopkins archives, medical imagery archive, and actually the person who invented the mastectomy actually was a surgeon at Johns Hopkins, so there's a fair amount of material there. And plus we have, as part of the one of, I'm one of the transmedia producers, but we just brought on another transmedia producer who is a well-known breast cancer doctor who teaches at Duke and is part of it, has worked with NIH, and he's connected to organizations and governments related to breast cancer throughout the world. And so he's in the process of connecting us to those organizations and helping us develop this world map, which will have a human face and a story face as a strong component of it, but we'll also have a strong data component as well in terms of, potentially, we'll see, epidemiological data, as well as organizations who help, you know, who provide assistance to people who are suffering from breast cancer and survivors of breast cancer. So that's something which is, you know, which is kind of one of my main focuses now. And then also I'm doing my first workshop in Africa this summer in South Africa at the Durban Film Festival. And so that's my fifth continent for my workshop. So I'm very excited about that. And the only continent missing is Latin America. So, you know, Brazil, Argentina, Chile, Colombia, etc. You know, time to make that happen so I can, you know, add, you know, so I can be semi-complete in my continents for the workshops. And then also we're probably going to be having the workshop, my Think Outside the Box Office workshop, come out online, you know, because I've been traveling so much, frankly, for the breast cancer documentary that I've actually not been doing as many workshops. And, you know, and it's time to just get the thing up online so people can access it for, I don't know what we're going to price it at, but it's going to be pretty reasonable so that people can access it from wherever, you know, in the world, and I won't then have to travel. And maybe we'll do some things similar to films where we'll have the workshop online, but maybe there will be a Skype. You know, it's that whole thing about added value that we were talking about earlier, you know, that maybe there will be an extra fee for a Skype session with me, or, you know, something along those, or maybe a Skype discussion group where 8 people to get together and we do a series of, you know, Google chats as part of that. And maybe we'll be doing that as part of that might be a crowdfunding reward, you know, actually, if we, you know, if I do the crowdfunding campaign for Bombit, you know, I'll probably be offering certain of my, you know, other services from my other brand, as part of, to enhance the Bombit crowdfund campaign. You know, because I realize I have 2 audiences. I have a, you know, a film, you know, the film distribution and marketing audience and people who are interested in that. And then, you know, Bombit has its own brand of people who are interested in graffiti and street art who probably aren't so interested in this other aspect. So, so that's pretty much what's happening for the next, you know, year. And then I have another, you know, I have a food project that I'm working on, and then, you know, a few other projects here and there, you know, filmmakers, consultancies that, you know, that I still do, you know, I still work with an additional 1 or 2 filmmakers a month, you know, whatever I have the time for, you know, in addition to these other larger projects. But part of, like, my long-term aim is to, and one of the things I'm excited about the breast cancer documentary is that the transmedia project is so robust, is because I do want to move into that realm. And one of the things, I don't know if you know, if I did this last year, is I consulted on some of the early stages of this Star Trek transmedia, the transmedia campaign for Star Trek Into Darkness. And they actually ended up only keeping my call to action, you know, that I developed, and then they didn't do anything else, which was sad. But, you know, that are you the 1701 is, I can say, I feel at least semi-proud that I contributed to that, even though the number is not, I would not have, I did not choose that number of the 1701. We had chosen a different number, but I think I'm allowed to say that. I'm on an NDA, but I think it's all, I haven't said anything that's in violation of my NDA, you know.
And now you're speaking in San Francisco?
Yeah, yeah. In the immediate future, like in the next 2 days, I'm going, not speaking, I'm participating in Ted's,
Ted Hope's
artist to entrepreneur workshop that he's doing up there, where it's bringing together tech people, distribution consultants, and filmmakers into kind of a lab environment. And then I'm still doing the IFP Filmmaker Labs, so I do that, you know, I'm doing that this year, probably keep on doing that. And that's really funny, I still run into filmmakers that, you know, have good films. Like I just ran into a doc filmmaker that is perfectly positioned to be in the IFP lab. They have a great project, and like they didn't even apply. It's just like, what are you guys doing? Apply. It's like, it's for first-time filmmakers, it's free, they give you lots of stuff, and it's like, you know, the applications are in the spring, and the labs start in late spring, early summer. It's like, you know, you should, filmmakers, you should apply for all these labs that are out there. There's so many opportunities for filmmakers in terms of labs and contests and things like that now. Maybe people have too many that they're involved in, but there's a lot of, you know, there's of course Sundance, but there's a zillion other ones.
Steven Soderbergh mentioned in his latest talk at the San Francisco International Film Festival that it doesn't matter if your film costs $5 million or $50 million, it still costs about $70 million in marketing and distribution to do a wide enough release to recoup costs. John, why do independent filmmakers continue to push for theatrical distribution when it's clear they do not have $70 million to compete in the theatrical market?
Well, I would say to that, that that's a very limited conception as to release opportunities. You know, that, you know, yes, he's talking specifically about a studio release pattern. And yeah, I'd agree it probably costs at least $70 million to engage a studio release pattern. But I think most filmmakers, when they want a theatrical release, you know, independent filmmakers aren't thinking about that. But I still, what I think is important to think about is to get out of that theatrical mindset, you know, and to think, and this is something I wrote in the book, that think about that it's a live event. It's an event. It's not theatrical or non-theatrical or anything of the standard terms that come from the studio world. And screw the studio world. It's like you're an artist and you're creating a certain kind of content and you're engaging audiences in a certain way. And one of the ways that you can engage audiences is through events. And for most independents, a traditional theatrical doesn't make sense, you know, but events make sense. So to think about why filmmakers want a theatrical release when they don't have $70 million is almost a straw man argument, because that's not even the question. The question is, what kind of release makes sense for your particular film, and to craft a release that does make sense for your film? And usually there's some kind of event component that does make sense for your film. It just depends on the particular film that's going to inform what kind of event component that is. To call filmmakers out for wanting to do a $70 million theatrical release, I think is potentially unfair, or not unfair, it's just not the right issue. I think the issue is that how are filmmakers going to engage their audiences and make audiences interested in their work? And that's the more interesting question.